Welcome to the Real Estate Marathon Podcast, your guide in the race to financial freedom through real estate investing and sound financial practices. This podcast is for anyone interested in learning more about real estate investing, personal finances, and a new take on traditional retirement. Now, here are your hosts, Larry Fierro and Mike Moe.
What's going on, everybody? Welcome to the Real Estate Marathon Podcast, your guide on the race to financial freedom through real estate investing and sound financial practices. My name is Mike Moe, one of the hosts of the show, joined in usual fashion with Mr. Fierro. What's up, man?
Keeping it real, mister. Keeping it real today.
Yeah, you living the retired life, or I shouldn't say retired life, the full-time real estate investor life?
I am. I talked to one of my friends that I used to work with quite regularly, and I told him, hey, what day is it today? When you're retired, you kind of lose track of that. And he was like, oh, shut up. But yeah, no, I had a very profitable day, my friend. One of the things that I had gotten a text message from one of the people I bought one of my houses, owner finance from, and they want to sell me eight more buildings for getting out of the landlord game completely, and they want to do an owner finance. So,
yep,
you know,
eight more buildings. How many more units? It's like 18 units, isn't it?
18 units. Yep. I went and looked at them today, checked them all out. Beautiful, beautiful properties. You know, got it all set to go, got it all locked up. Just got to wait to close on it.
I don't want to put you on the spot here, man, but you want to share with the listeners the terms you got on these things? I don't know if you if you don't have to.
No, I can.
If you're in you're in the middle of the transaction, but my God, did my jaw hit the floor when you said the terms?
One of those things that the seller's motivated. He knows that I'm a closer and I'm a performer on the notes.
You've built a relationship with this guy for the last how many years?
2 years. I've been buying this properties from him. And he finally had enough and basically told me that it was kind of a test to make sure that the owner finance scenario would work for him.
The first couple?
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. And when I had given the MFI and Summit, and we talked about it in the podcast on owner financing, once you prove that you can perform, the people will start bringing you more deals. You know, your deal flow increases. But the terms that we've negotiated are zero down, no money down, and no interest. I did give him what he was asking for him. So that was a win on his part. And the beautiful part about zero interest and no money down is you kind of come out of the gate with good cash flow. And, you know, it does need some repairs. There is a little bit of deferred maintenance on a couple of them. So I used that as a selling point. And I told him, I said, you know, I could use the down payment money to get the deferred maintenance all set and squared away. And the beautiful part about zero interest is basically every payment I make comes right off of principal.
Not basically, actually, 100%.
Well, I didn't want to sound like I was bragging, but heck yeah, 100% yeah, comes off of principal.
18-unit package deal, zero down, 0% interest, owner financed, and never went to a bank. Good God.
Double the size of my portfolio, and I was already making enough to financially retire. So
yeah, what you got? You 28 units? Huh?
Yeah,
28. All units. Owner financed. Never talked to a bank.
Haven't touched a bank yet.
That's fantastic, man. I'm glad you're able to share that.
I've got this crystal ball right here, and I'm actually looking at the crystal ball, and I see in my future Corvette. I just throwing that out there.
You couldn't convince your wife to do it before. No. Now you have some ammo. You got some, bargaining, you know.
What I'm going to do is I'm going to wait until, you know, maybe 5-6 months in, and I'm just going to call up the bank account, and I'm going to show her the deposits monthly, and I'm going to go,
Jeez, give me that Corvette, dude. If it were me, it'd be more like a Porsche, but one of those slick Teslas.
I always knew that when I was able to afford a Corvette, and I've been able to afford it for a while, but I couldn't do it comfortably.
Yeah.
And I saw this thing that said, if you want to buy a sports car, make sure you can pay for it 10 times over. And that's when you can afford it, and that's when you can buy it, and that's what I'm waiting on.
Heck yeah, man. Yep. Cool, then. That's an exciting announcement.
Yeah, a little bit of good news on the front. I was a little nervous about early retiring and getting out of my full-time job. And, you know, things are working out better than I thought, because I never would have even thought about it if I were still working full-time. When he sent me that text, I was like,
Yeah. Well, you know, would you have been able to? You got to work all the time. You might not have been able to get down there. To your point, you might not have had the bandwidth. I mean, good things happen when you dive, you know, head first into it. And that, like you said, man, that was a good decision. So,
yeah. Well, I was told that when, you'll know when it's time to leave your full-time job, when it starts hindering your real estate investing, and that's what it was doing.
Nice. That's awesome. So, plus I was bugging the crap out of you every time that we got on the call saying, did you quit yet? Did you quit?
Yeah. Yep. So, and, you were, but that's all right. You know, that's called motivation. And if I can inspire some people out there to at least try the owner finance, you know, it's not one of those things, like we said before on our podcast episode, and I said at the summit, it's got a bad rap. It's got a negative connotation, and that doesn't have to be like that. It doesn't mean that you can't afford to do a bank mortgage, but you're trying to protect what little mortgages you have in the space.
So. Yeah, yeah. And you get terms like that?
Yeah.
Why would you ever go to a bank?
Dude, honestly, I never would have asked for terms like that if it hadn't been for the episode with Chris Prefontaine, where he said mostly they want to get their asking price and they don't care about interest. And I threw that out there and he's like, sure.
That's all the negotiation. We're not sure.
Yeah,
all
right. Sure.
Well, I should ask for that before, huh?
Yeah. Yeah. Actually, how about you pay me interest for taking it?
There you go.
You know, I don't think you would have flown with that, but what are you going to do?
Probably not. Yeah, it's awesome.
So we got an exciting episode tonight, man. Episode number 40.
Number 40. Which is actually like 90 if you consider the, what are we at? We almost at 100, like all inclusive with the
73, I think, with all of our Monday morning motivations. Yeah.
There you go.
All right. 73. So,
but number 40 officially. And this is going to be a good one, man. It's going to be a fun one.
It is. I'm kind of excited because we've lined up some guests, haven't we, coming up to talk about this exact topic. And, you know, it's kind of one of the things that I've been excited about getting into the multifamily space is these syndications. And, you know, I'd like to get involved with as many syndications as I can just to, A, learn the process intricately from the inside out, and B, amass as many streams of income as possible.
Yeah. Yep. Syndication is just another tool in the tool belt, and it's kind of a daunting one to take on in a 45-minute episode because people spend years and years and sometimes decades in the industry before trying to tackle a syndication because they can be complex, but used right and used in the right scenarios, it can be a fantastic opportunity. Like I said, just another tool in the tool belt to take down a property that you might not be able to otherwise.
Yeah, and you've got to have as many tools in the tool belt as possible because, like you said, it's one of those things that if you can't make a property fit one way, try it another way. Try it another way. Try it another way. Don't just because one scenario doesn't work doesn't mean you can't eventually get to that point where you can just pull out another scenario and make it fit in that one.
Yeah, it's kind of that old saying, if you only have one way to do it, you're not going to be as versatile as some of the other investors. If the only way you know is how to buy properties to go to a bank and put 20% down, well, one, it's not all properties will qualify for that. And two, you're going to run out of money real quick. So to your point, owner financing, syndications, the other creative financing or creative deal structures, the more you know, the just the better you are, the better position you're going to be in to be able to close more properties versus that person who only knows go to the bank, put 20% down.
Absolutely. And, you know, and one of the things you got to be not afraid to hear no. Don't be worried about it. Just ask and, you know, if they tell you no, then you move on to your next tool.
Exactly. Yep.
So you want me to jump into the warm up, mister?
Yeah, dude, hit me with it.
All right. We're going to do real estate syndication for the warm-up. What a real estate syndication is a crowdfunding for real estate before crowdfunding for real estate ever existed. In its most simple form, both syndication and crowdfunding involve pooling capital with other individuals for a common purpose or a common goal.
Yeah. So, I mean, you said it, man, it's just pooling money together to take down a property. And it's typically pooling investor money where the investors are passive or limited partners or LPs within the investment. And it's pooling those monies with the people who have the money, but don't necessarily have the time. And then the people on the other side who are constructing the deal and putting it together who have the time, but don't necessarily have all the money to take on these, you know, multi-million-dollar deals. So,
and this is the perfect time to preface the next few the next few topics with the fact that we are not attorneys. We're not offering legal advice, and you should definitely consult a syndication attorney, crowdfunding attorney before you do any of the things we talk. We're just giving you a simple overview of what the process looks like. There's a lot more involved to it when you go step by step by step. So make sure you've got a good attorney on staff.
Yeah, well, this is, you know, we should have said this at the beginning. This is part of our investor basics, right? Syndication overview. That's the title of the episode. And, you know, that CYA, that announcement is key for a couple of reasons. One, because you're exactly right. We're not attorneys, and there's a lot of complexities of this. Like I said in the beginning, people go years and years and sometimes decades in this industry before tackling their first syndication because it's complex. And it's not just complex to the point like, oh, you screw it up, you lose money. You screw this up, you go to jail because you are essentially offering a securities by doing these syndications. And there are certain rules and regulations that you have to abide by when you are offering a securities, like the SEC. There's a lot of things that you need to make sure that you're doing on the right side of the law, or else you could find yourself in a very, very sticky spot. So to your point, Larry, one of your key team members on a syndication is a securities attorney or a syndication attorney who can help guide you and navigate you through some of the nuances of a syndication to make sure you're staying on the right side of the law.
Yeah, the attorney is basically a map through a minefield, and they're going to help you. They're going to help you get through without stepping in the wrong spot and getting yourself into a world of hurt.
Yeah, exactly. And let's break that down a little bit more. So the reason that you need a securities attorney or you need a syndication is because you are essentially, you're creating a security. You're creating an entity that you are selling shares of. So you think of this property. This property goes into typically an LLC. You're selling shares of the LLC that owns that property. You're not actually selling pieces of that property out. So when you're breaking up the LLC and you're selling out shares of it, it's just like, it's very similar to, you know, taking a company public and you're selling shares on the open market. A little different, but in the sense, that's why they look at it as a security.
Yep. And as we all know, the stock market and the SEC has very, very specific rules and regulations, and you could get into a whole lot of trouble if you do it something incorrectly.
Yeah, for sure. Plus, it's always good to have somebody in your corner to help you navigate, not just the legal side of it, but just, you know, people who've done that before. So if you have an experienced investor who's gone through this before, it's always good to have them on your team before trying to tackle one on your own.
It is. So do you want to start deconstructing a syndication? Want to give them kind of an overview of what it is?
Yeah. So we threw around a couple of terms, and I'm going to try to not get lost in the terms here, because we're going to define a lot of terms and we're going to speak in a lot of jargon, but we're going to make sure that we try to slow it down and define these all as we're going. So hopefully we don't lose the folks here as we go through this. So the couple that we talked about already, we talked about LPs or limited partners. These are typically the people who will put money into the majority of the people who put money into a property and buying a property in a syndication. There can be any number of limited partners. You know, I've seen syndications that have, you know, 7 or 8 partners up to, you know, 30, 40, 50, depending on the size of the property. The more partners, obviously, the more limited partners, the more paperwork, the more almost like handholding or babysitting, because these are investors who are investing with you. So there is an aspect of investor relations along with these lines. So obviously the more you get, the more admin responsibilities you have with that too. So those are the limited partners. And then you have the other side of it is the general partners. And these are the people who are finding the deal, managing the deal, putting the deal together, finding the capital or the money within the limited partners to raise and taking this across the finish line. They're also the people who are putting up what's called risk capital, which is all the money that takes to close a deal before it actually closes. So as a general partner, there's things like a lot of securities fees, right? A lot of lawyer fees. There's a lot of bank fees and loan fees and application fees and inspection fees, acquisition fees, you know, environmental surveys and things like that. All these have to get paid before the property actually closes. And what the general partners are doing is they're putting up that money ahead of time and they're getting refunded after the deal closes. But if the deal doesn't close, they're out that money. So the general partners are taking that from finding the deal to getting across the finish line. And then once the deal is closed, they're typically the ones that are asset managing the deals and then repositioning and then selling the deal as well. So the limited partner sits back and collects a check. Sometimes they'll jump on a webinar just to, you know, get updates about the deal or things like that. But a lot of the limited partners, the completely passive side of this.
Yeah, and the general partners are the ones who are accepting a majority of the liability for the project, if I'm not mistaken. You know, they
sign you're right.
on the dotted line. They're the ones who basically put their name and reputation in line with this property, and they get a lot of rewards, and they get a lot of liability and risks. So,
yeah, limited partner also extends to the limited liability as well. So as a limited partner, if I'm putting money into a syndication as a limited partner, the only thing I can lose is the money I put in there. I can't get sued. Somebody slips and falls on the property. I can't, lose my shirt and get sued. It's a limited partner. It extends to the liability factor as well, which is kind of nice. I mean, this is a great tool. It's a great tool. We need to look at this in both the lens of a great tool for people investing and creating syndications and using it to take down properties on the general partnership side. But it's also a great tool for people who want to get exposure into real estate, but just don't have the time. Like, I don't have the time to go find deals, to talk to brokers, to track them down, to manage them and whatnot. If I just got, a lot of high earners, like you said, doctors, lawyers, they want to get exposure to real estate just for the returns and the tax benefits of owning real estate, investing as a limited partner is a great idea.
And you can create, you can do limited partners on some, general partners on others. And it's just about creating those multiple streams of income that are going to allow you to achieve that financial independence and win the marathon to financial freedom so you can retire.
Yeah. Heck yeah, man.
Yep. Now there's a couple of different kinds of syndications. I know there's a 506C and a 506B, and it looks like they're extremely different on the way you can do several things with them. That's more of the SEC rules, correct?
Yeah, for sure. And, what these are is they're just different exemptions. And so, I made the connection between, selling a stock on Wall Street, taking a company public to a syndication. Well, one of the things that makes a difference are these exemptions, because it's very costly, super costly, and very time intensive to actually go through the registering process and everything to bring a company actually public and to sell shares of that company. So in order to, there's exemptions for real estate to basically make that a lot less time intensive and a lot cheaper to do. And there's two exemptions. There's a 506C and a 506B. So if you're doing, well, I shouldn't say just two exemptions. These are the most widely known and most widely used exemptions are the 506B and 506C. And yet, to your point, Larry, there are very key differences in both who you can invest in these deals and how to structure them. So I think 506C is one that we'll dive into first. And really what the 506C kind of dictates, the high level details around the 506C is you can have accredited investors only invest in your syndication. So what that means is you need to be an accredited investor, which if I'm remembering correctly, an accredited investor, it's $200,000 or more a year earning, or you can do $1 million. If you have a $1 million net worth, not including your home, your primary residence, you're considered an accredited investor. So in a 506C, you can only have accredited investors invest in your property. But the benefit is you can broadly advertise this. So we could say on this podcast, Larry, you got a deal with these 18 properties that you're doing. We're raising capital for them. Apply here, put your names here, and we can raise capital that way for them.
Yeah. And it's $200,000 for individual income, right? And $300,000 for married.
Yes.
And it has to be in each of the last 2 years. So you can't hit it last year, not the year before, and be considered an accredited investor. That's very important to note. And also the net worth exceeding $1 million can involve your personal residence. So exactly. If you live in a $1 million house and you have $250,000 in rental properties, you're not considered an accredited investor because you cannot use your primary residence.
Exactly. Yeah. And that's, to our point earlier, that's why it helps to have an attorney, because there's so much gray area. There's a lot of different definitions of what an accredited investor is. And those are the two common ones. But as you'll see, as we continue to talk through the different terms and the different structures, there's a lot of gray area in these definitions. And some of them aren't clearly defined by the SEC. So it's always good to have somebody to help you navigate that. But yeah, those are the two most common ways of becoming an accredited investor. A few other ones, you know, if you've been a general partner before, some things along the lines, if you have a business that, you know, has a net worth of so much, but the most common ones are those two that you said.
Yeah, and those are, they have to be vetted by a third party source, is that correct?
Yeah.
So if you're running a syndication, you actually have to have all of your potential investors prove to a third party that they are accredited investors before you get in trouble.
You have to prove it. Not necessarily a third party. You can't just say word of mouth. You can't just say checkbox and say, yep, you're accredited. Cause that won't fly. Obviously, if it comes to it and, you know, the SEC comes down and looks at what you're doing, you can't just say, well, they told me they're accredited and you're off the hook. So you do have to validate. There are third parties that do it, which a lot of investors, I think feel more comfortable with, because instead of giving you, Larry, all my tax returns for the last 2 years, I'm giving a third party company that's just validating it and saying, yep, they're good.
Nice. And then the next exemption is that 506B. And the main difference between 506B, I mean, there's a lot of differences, but I always think of it as the 506B, you cannot advertise. Whereas yeah. The 506C, you can.
Yeah, the 506B, you cannot advertise publicly. And there's a couple other stipulations on who can invest in your deal as well. So this is why, or I would say at least in my opinion, newer syndicators usually go with the 506B, is because based on who you can invest in, who can invest in that deal. Technically, it's not just limited to accredited investors. It's limited to accredited investors, and then 35 sophisticated yep. investors. So what a sophisticated investor is, it doesn't have to be somebody who's got that $1 million net worth or a, you know, the $200,000 or $300,000 joint income per year. But it's somebody who understands the financial markets. And again, there's no clear definition what a sophisticated investor is, but the general guideline is somebody who understands the offerings and the risk entailed that's included with the offering of the syndication. So, because a lot of newbie syndicators don't know, you know, a bunch of accredited investors who's $1 million net worth because they haven't done this before, or a lot of accredited investors won't put their money with syndicators who aren't well experienced. Most newbie syndicators will go with the 506B because they can do these sophisticated investors as well.
Yeah. And another one of the things that a 506B is, since you can't advertise it, the best way you have to prove that you didn't advertise it is every person that invests in your syndication, you have to have a pre-existing relationship with, right? And that that has to be prior to whatever deal you're working on at that point. So if you meet somebody after you've already offered this syndication, you have to wait until the next syndication before you can offer it to that person. You have to it has to be pre-existing before whatever property you're syndicating, if I'm correct on that.
Yeah, you're correct. And it's pre-existing relationship before the property is identified. So if you, like, let's use your 18 units as an example. You identified that property whenever that dude sent you that text, right? That's when that was a potential property that you were looking at. You need to have those pre-existing relationships before that point of property identification. So you can't find a property. This is what I hear a lot, is I'm going to find a property and then we'll find the investors. Well, technically that's not by the abiding by the rules and regulations of the SEC, because you need to have these pre-existing relationships before the property is even identified.
Nice, nice. Yep. And that's, like you said, it's one of those things that this is where a proper attorney can really be worth their weight in gold.
Yeah. And they'll help guide you to the less common but still risky things that you might not even think are risky. So if you're going to a meetup and it's a public meetup and there's people in the room and you're talking about, if you're even talking about that deal and somebody overhears that and you're in a public setting where people can hear that deal and then they invest with you, that's risky. You can't put, you can't post anything about this on social media, you know, Twitter, any of your social media accounts. You can't post anything about this, because even if you're not specifically saying, hey, we're raising capital for this, if you even say, hey, we got this awesome deal and it's a 12 unit, here's where it is, and somebody reaches out to you and wants to invest with you, that's considered advertising it. And if you have the 506B, you can't do that. So you got to be very careful about who you tell about the deal, where you're talking about the deal, and making sure that people overhearing you aren't going to then come in and try to invest in it. And then obviously you don't have that pre-existing relationship, right? That'd be considered advertising. So
you can't go down to the local Cheers pub and talk to Norm about investing in your deal. Considered advertising.
Well, unless you know Norm and unless you have a pre-existing relationship, but let's be honest, if there's somebody else in the bar, somebody sitting next to you, they hear about that. Yeah, that's where you want to make sure that you're being careful about who's in the vicinity of when you're talking about these deals. And it sounds like, yeah, right. Like, you know, how is anybody could connect the dots between that? But that's where you'd rather be safe than sorry.
Yeah. Everything works out well until it doesn't. And then you're going to wish you were covered.
Yeah. And it's those gray areas. Like what defines a pre-existing relationship? Good question, man. Cause it's not clearly defined. There's a typical assumed guideline that a pre-existing relationship is three touches, and not just three touches like, hey Larry, how you doing? That counts as one, but three good conversations about investing and about your financial ability to take a loss and to invest in this. So it's not, like I said, like a conversation about the weather, but if you're seriously interested in investing with me as a syndicator, we would have at least three conversations about the, you know, potential deal, not potential deals, but likely, you know, target returns and, you know, your ability as an investor to do so, to get in the deal.
Yeah, excellent information, sir. Now, say I'm wanting to invest in a syndication as a general partner, which is something that I'm actually considering. I want to jump into this basically feet first. I want to know what's going on. What kind of, we'll say, activity or role could I assume as a general partner that's going to get me involved in this syndication?
Good question. So there's a handful of main roles in a general partnership. First one is investor relations, just because, like I said, you're essentially taking other people's money, right? So when people give you money, and this isn't a small sum of money. Typically, a lot of syndications will have a minimum investment of $100,000. You can get it for less, but because of the, you know, multi-million dollars that are typically raised for this, and because, again, like we talked about, the admin-like tasks that are associated with having a bunch of investors, people don't typically want to take, you know, $10,000, $15,000, $20,000 investments. They want to take $100,000 investments. So the investor relations will, you know, obviously have those conversations, set those expectations with the investor, host like the webinars, send out the either the monthly or quarterly recaps, whatever that you do as a syndication team. They'll also typically be the person that raises the capital as well. So this person has a really good investor list, has got a ton of investors that they've already got pre-existing relationships with. They touch base with on a regular basis to make sure that they're, you know, keeping a pulse on what their investor can do and keeping that relationship warm. So when a deal comes along, it's easy to fund that deal. But typically the person raising the capital will a lot of times do the investor relationships as well. So all the communication, all the, you know, the handholding, the reaching out, it's with that investor relationship person.
Yeah. And the one that I always zone in on when we're talking about a role for the general partner, I always see as being asset management, where you would actually go in and be in charge of running the asset. I mean, after your acquisition, you're in charge of dealing with property managers, you're in charge of dealing with renovations, remodeling, things like that. And, you know, whenever I think of a syndication and the general partnership, this is the one that I actually focus on and figure that that's what I would have to be doing without even realizing that there's other roles that you can actually do to get involved with these syndications as a general partner.
Yeah. Tons of different roles, but yeah, you're right. The asset management role is a great role. And your point, it's the property's bought. Now it's implementing that business plan. Typically there always should be a business plan associated with whatever property you're buying in a syndication, because people want to know what your plans are. Typically, people are just buying these properties and then sitting on them. I mean, this is usually there's a some sort of repositioning of the property with either renovations or turning the property tenants around or what have you. So there's a business plan to realize the extra value in the property, right? So the asset manager will make sure that the business plan is being implemented, that it's on track, that everything is going accordingly, and take those tracking of the reposition so they can report out either monthly or quarterly, however they want to their investors. So,
yep. And that next role there, acquisitions, is that a big role in GP?
So a lot of these can be duplicated by one person. Mm-hmm. Sometimes acquisitions, asset management is the same person. But acquisitions is, to your point, it's just locating the property and going through a lot of the legwork to close the property. So again, as you know, there's a ton of red tape and of paperwork and legwork to get a property from identified to close. Things like we talked about with inspections and environmentals and different, loan applications and things like that. And that's the person who's, running the acquisition will typically do. So there's a lot of times there's an acquisition fee associated with that will largely go to that person or the entire GP, general partners, depending on how you guys negotiate it. And that's anywhere from 1-3% of the 1-3% of the actual sale of the cost of the property. So it could be a sizable fee, but it's because there's a ton of legwork and there's a ton of risk. So there's a lot of, tens of thousands of dollars, depending on the size of property. I mean, it'd be hundreds of thousands of dollars, depending on the size of property, that you need to put up before the property even closes. And like you said, if it doesn't close, you're out that money. So it is risk there. So, but yeah, that's a typical role of, acquisition, sourcing properties, keeping really good, the deal flow going and really, broker relationships up. So.
Yeah. And, being from New York, I've been looking in the Tampa MSA, and one of the things that I knew that I probably wouldn't be able to get involved with the GP in this next role is the boots on the ground, the team on the ground, even though I would love to live in Florida. And that basically means that, you get somebody that lives in the area that you're investing. They're your representative on the ground locally. So if you have to have somebody go over to the property, have to meet with somebody, do inspections, keep track of roofers. And they're actually a big part of running over and checking on these properties and keeping you updated on a regular basis as to, I guess accountability would be the best way to put the team on the ground. They're there for the accountability, making sure everything is getting done well. And like you said, that could be a role fulfilled by the asset manager as well.
Yeah. And, not every GP has boots on the ground or, that person just on, at the local market, just because, Vince said, when we interviewed him, he's got a team on the ground, but he doesn't necessarily have boots on the ground. And let's be honest. So we have a pie, right? Which is the general partnership. And that's got to be split up so many ways. So if a role can be eliminated or if it can be handled, multiple roles by one person, they typically will, because the only thing you're doing by adding more people in the general partnership is slicing that pie smaller and smaller for everybody else. So a lot of times, this, to your point, the boots on the ground will be the, help with asset management, will help with acquisitions and things like that. But yeah, there's somebody there who can either coordinate like those large rehabs, almost like, project manage those rehabs with the subcontractors and things like that, or do, whatever various, actions you need to do in the local market that you can't do from afar, or that you can't have your property manager do.
Yep. And I think everybody that goes into real estate or syndication eventually wants to be the KP or the key principal. And this is the big gun. This is the big hitter. What's the KP?
Yeah. Key principal, man. And, the reason sometimes you need a KP is, let's talk about the financing that you typically need for a lot of these properties. So your general partnership in a syndication, depending on the financing. So this isn't a steadfast rule, but a lot of times we'll need to have a combined net worth of the loan balance. So if you got, if you're buying a $5 million property and you're getting a $4 million loan on it, you guys all need to have a net combined, need to have a net worth of $4 million. There's also liquidity requirements depending on the bank, again, that you need to have post-close liquidity. So if you're putting up, you know, $100,000 of your own money combined, the general partnership needs to have so much liquidity after close. So if you don't have that, there's ways to get around it. And that's with the KP, a key principle. That is, to your point, the high roller, the big dog who comes and just puts their balance sheet up and says, yep, I got the liquidity, I got the net worth. And you typically get anywhere from 5 to 10%, sometimes more of that than the GP, just for doing, just that's it, just for putting your balance sheet up and your liquidity up. Now, the beauty of it is a lot of times these are non-recourse loans, which means if the property gets foreclosed on, they don't come back on you for any sort of financials left on the property. The bank just takes the property. So you're not putting your balance sheet actually on the line in a lot of these loans. So it's really a fantastic role to be in if you got the balance sheet.
10% for saying, hey, this is my bank account.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
It's a key role. It's a needed role because you're not closing the property without it. If you don't have that liquidity, if you don't have that that net worth that you need to close the property, then obviously it's not happening. So it's still a needed role. People look at these as, sometimes they get looked at as selfish old folks, but let's be honest. I mean, if you're in that position, good for you. You did some work to get there, and you still need a piece of the puzzle.
Absolutely. Now, in syndication as a general partner, let's get into a little bit of the pros and cons of a syndication, as a general partner. I mean, the LP, we can deal with that at a different time, but the general partner is really the one that's got the most risk. So let's talk about the pros and cons of that.
Yeah, I think we definitely need to talk about the LP side more in depth, maybe in the following episode, because I think, it's like I said at the beginning, it's a really good lever to get in as the LP. You can learn a lot, but you can also get exposed to real estate without having to do a lot. So, but yeah, we're going to look at this from the lens of a GP. And first, before we jump into that, like we said at the beginning, this is a tool. Like Vince said when we interviewed him a couple episodes, a lot of people get into real estate and they're like, I want to syndicate. Like, it's this holy grail of real estate, when really it should just be viewed as this tool in the tool belt. It is not like... every deal doesn't have to be a syndication. If you can close it elsewhere or other means, typically, I generally would, in my personal opinion, but that's, yeah. So just throw that out there. It's not, every deal doesn't have to be syndication, and it's not like this holy grail of real estate investing. So
no, you ultimately want to start buying these larger projects by yourself, have your own balance sheet and things like that and be able to close on them. But until you get to that point,
Yeah, 100%. I'm with you, man. I think I told you off the air at one point in time, like, my goal eventually, with the syndications is to get enough to throw like these larger properties down on my own, because this first con is exactly that reason, which is, when you're doing a syndication, you essentially need to flip apartment complexes every 5 to 7 years. You can't typically plan to hold on to a property for more than, say, 7 years. Mostly at the most. And here's the reason why, because most investors who are giving you $100,000, they don't want you to say, all right, we'll get your money back in 10 or 12 years. No, they typically want their money returned to them in 5 to 7 years. It's usually the temperament of the investor, right? So in order to do that, you need to reposition that property and sell it within 5 to 7 years. Also, to be competitive and to offer the returns that are competitive among syndicators, you typically need to find something that you can reposition and benefit from the additional capital return of a sale. So you're essentially flipping these longer flips, right? 5 to 7 years, it's a longer flip, but it's not something that you can buy and hold forever. And for me, I look at like real estate. I want to do like the Warren Buffett style of real estate investing. I want to buy something and I want to never sell it. Or at least for a long time. I just want to collect the cash. So I don't want to have to reposition these every 5 to 7 months. Years. That's kind of one of the cons of the syndication stuff.
So an accelerated exit plan.
For sure. Yeah, yeah. That's an easy way to say it. I went the long winded route, but yeah.
Yeah. You know, that's not a problem, man. I would have thrown it in there earlier, but I was just enthralled by listening because you got a great amount of knowledge on this and my experience in syndication is limited at this point. So I'm learning just as much as the listeners, and that's why I'm trying to represent them by asking you questions on what's going on. The next one there, the people management, that's one of the cons because the investor expectations, you have to talk to the investors, you have to keep them updated, you have to keep them posted, whereas if you own the property outright, you're actually the one that has to be in on top of the situation, but you don't have to share that information if you don't choose to.
Yeah, and it's you know, it's just that it's an added layer and the added complexity of emotion and money, right? Like people are giving you large chunks of change. Like they're giving you six figures of their own hard earned money, right? So they typically want a lot of communication and a lot of, I don't want to say like white glove treatment, but like if they have a question, they want a response and they want it now. Right. And like, rightfully so, they give you $100,000 of their money or $200,000 of their money. You should respond to them. Right. So it's just that people management. If you got 25 investors on one property and you got five properties, well, how many you got 100 investors, right? So, that, you know, or yeah, well,
125
this. Yeah, good math for you. Right? You got a ton of investors that you got to manage mm-hmm. those expectations. And that's not easy. So
it's not. And you're dealing, like you said, you're dealing with a lot of high emotion because, you know, $100,000, I don't know about you, but $100,000 is a big hit for most people.
Yeah.
When you're considering the number of people that live paycheck to paycheck, you know, that don't, 100,000 is a lot of green. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. For sure.
And so then you
definitely got to deal with that.
Yes. Yep. So, and the GP syndication is more expensive, right? There's a lot more fees and a lot more things associated with it.
Yeah, there's a lot of fees. So the loan fees can typically be higher because you're underwriting, you know, however many people in the general partnership. For the asset management itself, you know, you got to do the distributions. You got to either buy a software, you got to do that manually, and, you know, cut those checks, do the direct deposit, and just the accounting side of that on a monthly and a quarterly basis. From a tax perspective, you got to make sure somebody's getting out their K-1s, which is if you're a limited partner or an LP, you get a K-1 everywhere, which is just your tax, you know, document that you'll give it to your accountant at the end of the year to record your losses or your gains on that. So, there's a lot of expense to it. The other side of it is a PPM, which is a large document that you essentially need in a syndication, which costs, you know, $15,000 to $20,000 private placement memorandum, if I'm remembering the definition correctly. Yeah. Those can cost $15,000 to $20,000 for a lawyer to draw up. And that's essentially the CYA of the syndication. So you present it to your investors, they hopefully read through it. It's a multiple page, 20, 40, 50, 60 page document that just tells them all the ways that they can lose money, just like everything you need, your terms and conditions, right? Think of it as like the fine print of your credit card bill that nobody ever reads, but you probably should, because there's a tons of information that shows you how you're liable. Same thing with this, not liable, but how you could lose money. Mm-hmm. The other side of it too is, you know, if you're doing a small fee, but you know, if you're doing a syndication, typically you need a lot of marketing materials, or you need a, you know, credibility book or something to present that deal effectively to your investors. That's not a large cost, but it's, you know, added on there as well.
Yep. Yep. Now, some of the pros for being a GP, I know one of them is one that I like, and it allows you to scale your business quicker. And that's generally when you see somebody that tells you they went from, you know, five units to 1,500 units in 4 years. I don't know many people who can do that without syndication. So, you know, that does allow you to scale your business a lot faster. And that just gives you another leap and bound towards that marathon for financial independence.
Yeah, man. So to your point, if you want to scale and you want to scale quickly, syndication is a great tool to do it because if you think about, you know, my market, the market that I'm investing in, you know, average property goes for, you know, say 60 to 70,000 a unit. If you're looking at a 70 100 unit property, you know, 6 to $7 million for that property, you know, 20% down. Most people aren't doing that on their own, right? So if you want to scale to lots of units and lots of cash flow, then a syndication is an easy way to do it. It's not the only way to do it, because Larry yourself is a great example. 28 units, no syndication, no partners, full financial freedom, right? So it's all about your goals and making sure you're using that, the right tool to achieve those.
Absolutely. You know, it's you want to definitely use whatever tools you have to get to that financial freedom number, because speaking from experience, once you become financially free, I was telling the gentleman that kind of got upset with me when I lost track of what day it was today. I told him that, and I said, honestly, my lifestyle, my stress level, my quality of life was 10x'd in the matter of a month and a half. And I just can't even describe it, man. Like, I'm getting up tomorrow morning and I'm going golfing at 9 o'clock in the morning with my son.
9 o'clock on a Thursday.
Yeah. 9 o'clock on a Thursday. You know, it's not going to make me any better of a golfer being 9 o'clock on a Thursday. I might as well be golfing at midnight on Saturday, but you know, cause I can't see the ball anyway, either way. So
yeah, man, it was a weekend real estate seminar, you know, I don't know what class, whatever you want to call it. Yeah. And Bill Hamm, one of the coolest things he ever said, is like, being a real estate investor, like every day is a Tuesday afternoon. Like there's not a Saturday, there's not a Sunday, which can sometimes suck because, you know, Saturday midday, you got something going on in your properties, or you got a property closing, you know, it's a sprint for the next, you know, 2-3 months, whatever you have it, but everything's a Tuesday afternoon. So that's awesome.
Yep. Yeah. But by the same token, every day can be a Saturday afternoon.
Yeah. Yeah.
As exactly. Well. So,
love it.
And then another pro is, using OPM, that other people's money, man.
Yeah. And which, I mean, it kind of goes hand in hand with scaling, right? Like you're not going to have, most people don't have millions and millions and millions of dollars to put in real estate. And if you do, you're probably not putting in real estate. Just go stick that thing in an index and collect this, you know, 8 to 10% of the year. Anyways. So being able to use other people's money, you're able to scale a lot quicker. To your point, you can get into properties. I won't say no money down, because typically, as a limited partner, you like to see the general partners putting some skin in the game. You want to see typically 10% of the overall funds needed for the property should be provided by the general partners. But sometimes it's a lending requirement too. But
yeah. And then you can create that win-win-win scenario as a general partner. What exactly is the win-win-win? Because that sounds good. I like it where everybody wins.
Yeah. It just goes back to as somebody who wants to be in real estate, who is in the industry and who is hustling for these deals, it creates them a win as being the general partner and putting those deals together, because you get paid off and without a lot of money in the deal yourself. You get acquisition fees, which are, you know, typically, like I said, 1 to 3% of the property sale. So if you're got a $5-6 million property, that's a good payout. You also have ongoing asset management fees sometimes, which again, it's calculated differently. Sometimes 1 to 3% of the gross income on the property. It could be off the equity raise. There's a couple different ways to do it, but so you get a good payout for hustling. The other win is it provides people, like I said, exposure to real estate who don't want to hustle. Like, I want to get exposure to real estate because tax benefits are fantastic, the returns are good, and because maybe it kind of interests you and you want to learn about it and kind of get those, you know, sit on those webinars and get those quarterly updates and just kind of understand it and learn a little bit. Perfect opportunity for that. For those high income earners, like I said, brings down their tax liability quite a bit. And then that third one is you just providing a ton of opportunities to grow your business and to employ, you know, whether it be property managers, contractors, subcontractors, by doing a lot of these repositions and these rehabs and in doing business, you're obviously employing a ton of people. So, and yeah. I should say fourth one, man, you're providing a great opportunity for a great place for people to live, a great home for people to find.
Absolutely. And I'll even add a fifth win. It's one of the 7 streams of income for every millionaire out there. So
there you go.
You get to check that off your box as well. Well, that's everything I've got.
Yeah, no, that's, I think that's all we had for the syndication. So like we said at the beginning, this is investor basics. This is an overview. People spend a ton of time trying to learn syndications ins and outs before they actually perform them. So we will dive a little bit deeper into how to vet, you know, general partners from a, you know, if you're looking to invest in a syndication as a limited partner, for as a passive investor, in the following episode. But hopefully this is a primer to let you dive a little bit deeper into the syndication world.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to talking to some of the people that we're bringing, the guests that we're bringing in for syndications that have been in there. They've been in the game for a while. They've got syndications under their belt and they can actually give you an in-depth, like what are some of the pitfalls? That's what I'm interested in, because, you know, it's not going to all be a sunny day. You're going to have some rainy days and you know, we want to try and get you some answers on what kind of pitfalls you need to be aware of and how to try and avoid them.
Yeah. I mean, it's not all rainbows and butterflies, and that's what I wanted to get across originally is, you know, syndications aren't always the way to go. It's not always the holy grail of investing. We'll get some heavy hitters on from the syndication side to kind of give us the real side of syndications and talk about some of the goods and the bads.
Yeah. So what are you thinking we should do for a call to action? You think we should have them look up some syndications, or, you know, look into getting involved in some syndications properly, or?
Oh man, that's a great question. I probably should have thought of that ahead of time. You know, I think if you're looking at syndications, I would understand what you think your role would be in a syndication. So we talked about the roles of a GP and the couple main key roles of a general partnership. Do you fit in there? Do your skills fit into any one of those buckets? Do your interests fit in any one of those buckets? Or on the flip side, are you interested in doing an LP? And if you are, dive a little bit deeper, find a sponsor or a syndicator that is interested in the market that you are interested in, start connecting with them. So I'd say that, man, if you're looking at doing a GP, figure out what your role is. And if you're thinking about doing LP, connect with some sponsors, who are looking at the market you are. And we'll dive a little bit deeper in how to vet those sponsors and how to find, syndicators doing deals.
And I would add a second part of it, just a small second part. One of the advice that you and I got from one of our accountability pod partners was that you should actually start putting your balance sheet, your personal balance sheet together. You know, make sure that you put that personal balance sheet together so you know what you can bring to the table for a syndication, you know, get an accurate picture.
Yeah. If you Google personal financial statements, there's some templates out there, which will align with what a lot of banks will ask you for when you're going for either commercial finance or it's a lot of times just residential financing. But it's always good to have your balance sheet and your personal financial statement updated so you know what you can bring to the table in a general partnership or as a KP or, you know, either one of those roles.
Yep. Well, that was a very informative episode. I'm happy that we were able to, you know, scratch the surface of it. And I'm looking forward to some of the guests we got coming up.
Yeah, me too, man. That was a good one. Like you said, scratch the surface of it. This is a complicated, complex task or undertaking. So we'll get some more folks on here to share some more knowledge on it as well. So
sounds great.
Cool. All right. Thank you guys for tuning into another episode of the Real Estate Marathon Podcast. We'll see you next time.
You guys take care.
Thanks for listening to the Real Estate Marathon Podcast. If you found value in any of the content from this show, consider supporting us in the following ways. Subscribe to the Real Estate Marathon Podcast. Leave a rating and review. Continue the conversation with like-minded individuals on social media by heading over to the Real Estate Marathon Podcast Facebook group or follow us on Instagram and Twitter @ Real Estate Marathon Podcast.